Well, as far as I can understand it, we were on that planet where we had gotten sued for that thing which somebody did, which we all promised never to bring up again.
Oh my God, Spencer.
I thought you said never bring it up again.
I didn't bring it up. So,
I forgot we're still getting sued. Yeah, and we met with that robot lawyer that we think might have an agenda or is working for someone else.
Yeah, Sanja, the robot lawyer.
Yep. So that's going on.
Well,
and,
technically, she is a cyborg.
A cyborg, of course, sorry.
Cyborg, right?
It's in the future, there is a distinction.
Robot with people parts. Mm-hmm. So, that's going on. I'm just throwing things out. So that's going on. We are in a hotel because we're trying to. The trial's like this week or something. I can't remember the exact time.
I think you're on your way. I can't remember. I can't remember when we. Cut off.
That's why we ended. We were like, we don't really want to deal with all of this at this late at night.
We'd gotten started with another thing. Like, we knew that the AI that had killed Pilgrim had broken off, escaped.
Yep.
Yeah. Into this planet.
Phantom.
Phantom. So Phantom had escaped onto this planet, and we had kind of warned the authorities, but, you know, it ain't gonna work.
Spencer's character shot the robot.
Yeah.
Yep.
AwesomeBot 9001 is no more. Rest in peace.
Rest R.I.P. in pieces.
Pepperonis.
Rest after Pagemex. Alright. So, that's going on. Then the authorities have gotten on our tail because we've been in contact with the feminist something or other.
We got caught up with the feminists.
Yeah. It's feminists.
I have no idea where you're going with this, but there is apparently a group of really radical armed...
Bunuel Feminist Alliance, yeah.
Yeah, radical. And they are leaning... They're apparently rebels against the ruling government of this planet, and they're leaning on us really, really hard to do something, but we kind of, like, we don't know what's going on. But they're leaning on...
agreed to nothing.
Yeah, we agree to nothing, but they're using threats to get us to agree to something, and we don't know what.
Yeah, we're just hopefully we get out of here.
I kind of remember that now, yeah.
Why did we get him?
What are we doing?
Because otherwise, well, there's no story. It's fun this way. Hey, if you didn't get involved with the feminists, you would have gotten involved with somebody else.
He cleans.
And the same thing would have happened. You would have... Somebody would have wanted to murder you anyway.
And then, while this is going on, the cops come looking for the feminists, who are apparently staying in the hotel that we're staying in, and then there was a setup for a fight, and then the power went out.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, so we're about to kill somebody?
So we got farther than I remember. So let me give you a little background on Bunuel real quick, and then... if you have any goals, new goals, or anything like that, let me know. I can't remember the last time you guys were on this planet, if I had the same idea or not, but I wanted to make a cyberpunk planet, and I thought, like, how am I going to do that? So, the entire planet's not... covered in city. It's not like Coruscant. Basically, it's tidally locked. So it's tidally locked to its star. So one side of the planet is perpetually daytime and it's scorching hot. The other side of the planet is dark and cool. So there's basically a giant city at the terminus that basically runs around the entire planet. All of the dark parts are like manufacturing, like automated, like robot factories and stuff like that. So you could, so when you're coming in from the dark side of the planet, it's, you know, the whole planet looks like it's lit up by all these like factories and stuff, but really the only habitable part of the planet is this narrow band around the equator that the city is, everyone just calls it the city. It's split up into like different quadrants and sections and all that stuff, but you don't really need to know that. Everyone just calls it the city. And yeah, like the rich people will live in the in these like these like habitats, these like engineered habitats that are like super expensive to maintain, like up on hills and stuff like that, where there's actual grass and sunlight. And super expensive because they have to, yeah, they have to contend with the constant daylight and the super super hot temperatures. And then in the, like the city proper, it's almost perpetually raining just because of all the hot air coming in from the daylight side to the nighttime side. And so yeah, it's Cyberpunk Planet.
Alrighty.
And so did I name the hotel that you guys were at? See, all these details get fuzzy right at the end.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
The Electric Sheep.
That would be awesome.
Alright, yeah, let's go with that.
Sweet!
Dream of electric sheep?
Okay.
Cameron's idea.
The Electric Sheep.
One of the names stuck. Awesome.
Eventually it would have. You throw so many out. It's a matter of numbers.
A little over a year.
Eventually. One of them's got to work. It's usually like you throwing out names and I'm like, no, that doesn't really fit. And then you throw out more and I'm like, no.
You throw out more and you're like, okay, we're
just
done.
Yeah, just you're now you're distracting me and I can't think of anything that's good now. Okay, so it's a very vertical city. The Electric Sheep has the ground floor is it's like a small little lobby area that spills into like a bar slash casino. There's a front desk that's manned by a robot. A robot takes your bags and stuff if you have any.
Thank you.
There's the lobby is open like a couple of floors up. You see like a game room upstairs, and then like some sort of like cafeteria thing above that. So everything's like very vertically built. There's a lot of space is very premium on the ground floor. So most of the like shops and stuff that you passed by in your taxi ride are like built on top of each other, and then people just park on whatever floor they want to go to. There's like sky ramps and stuff like that for pedestrians. Advertisements everywhere. Even your taxi cab had it was like cash cab where all the like lights inside light up, and then like there's advertisements inside the taxi cab.
Well, sure. I'm glad I invested in an ad blocker.
Are you a walking ad blocker? You send out like an EMP.
just like a slight program in my PDA that just kind of winks Windows off.
Yep. You see, like a lot of the ads are. You see a lot of them like get hacked. Like people like hack the ads to like basically turn into like graffiti. So it's this like constant struggle throughout the city of like basically people defacing electronic advertisements with electronic graffiti and like all this stuff. The hotel that you get to seems fairly upscale. It doesn't look like it's in a bad part of town, or at least their security is pretty good because they don't have any defaced ads. There's no like porn ads and stuff like that, like just blanketing the hotel like you've seen in like some other parts of town. Yeah, like something appears, it's like click this and win a free iPod Nano. Just appears.
Man, retro tech. Awesome.
So is there any new goals for you guys? Anything other than get through the mission, which is going to be to, I guess, win the trial?
Not be sued, please?
To not
yeah, lose. I've been spending my money pretty freely and not really taking jobs that they want to do.
Goal is not to go to jail here. That'd be nice. Go to jail.
That would be bad.
Yeah, give Lamont a lot of crap about it.
I don't feel like that needs to be written down as a goal. This is going to happen in.
Oh, it's going down.
I think it should be a group goal. When we complete it.
We call those missions. when you finish a mission, you get experience. Yeah.
Everyone except for Lamont.
Yeah, well, of course. I can't hold to give myself crap.
You have to just take however much it was for the trial. That's how much XP you have to take off.
Fuck! That would be the worst if that's how that went. Especially if I didn't have like all that XP.
You had to repay it somehow. basically just I think we took on this Bunuel feminist society because since for some reason it was gonna help us find Joe and get Joe back or something like that. Because he's still with a high beam.
Yeah, Joe's with the pirates. You need some faction on your side.
And we've already got the. Because
you're not
going
to be able to take on the high beam by yourselves.
Yeah, we've already got the Ragnarok Society on Jeanette's.
Yep.
And they're disposed.
Yeah, they're still fighting that.
So, yeah, we were hoping to get the people from Majez, but we were basically exhausted that for a while.
Yeah.
For a while, yeah.
So we need to find another one. And I think that's why we took on this feminist group.
Yeah, I don't really remember. I kind of, like, pre-barricaded as long as I could while they were, like, making threats. So that was you guys made that decision.
Oh. Thanks.
I'm a non-combat character.
Non-combat character.
Stuck in front of murder lady.
Oh.
I am no good without like large amounts of prep.
I was going to ask who is murder lady. Ah, yes, indeed. Yeah. Okay. Okay, let's go do the trial and then. So what planet are we on right now? Bunuel?
Bunuel.
And we're in the hotel.
And the government is, are they owned by a certain organization or a corporation? Like, is High Beam somehow involved with all of this?
High Beam's involved with everything, but
yeah,
I don't know.
Like, specifically, do they have, like, a huge stake in this planet? I understand, yeah, High Beam is literally, like, our Hydra.
Yeah.
So Bunuel is a lot harder to actually do anything with in terms of like investing and stuff like that. It's very easy to like break into the market on Bunuel, but it's very hard to like export stuff because they have a lot of export taxes and they don't like proprietary tech being stolen. Everything's basically owned by the government, but you're like free to like have your own business and sell things as long as it has a license and like everything's properly up to code and
etc.
etc. But everything is controlled by the government, which is controlled by these lords of Bunuel. These it's basically like 7 people, I think it is. I can't remember where my notes. But yeah, a handful of like autocrats basically just run the entire planet.
And there are these like ancient families.
Yep.
That have been just running the planet basically for generation after generation.
Yep.
Okay. And
we take one of them off.
And of course we did. And they're a fairly prosperous society or not?
Oh yeah, there's tech everywhere.
Like their export tax is not a hindrance enough to keep it. Basically, it's backwater, is what I was asking.
It's very, it's like a planet that would be very rich. It would be probably the richest planet in the sector if they exported more. They build a lot of components here, like Starship components. There's a lot of companies that do that. If you want cybernetics, like cybernetic augmentation, you go to Bunuel. Like, this is basically the only place you can get it done correctly, outside of like maybe like certain private practices. So you see people walking around like completely like teched up, and at the same time they don't look very well off. There's definitely a income disparity here. There's definitely like a lower class, but in terms of like the amount of resources they have and the technology they have, it's definitely impressive.
So basically it's just they have a wealth disparity, they have a lower class, but they're maintained.
Yeah.
Okay. Okie dokie.
Because everything is so regimented, it's difficult for people to move between those, income classes.
You have your place here, basically.
Yeah.
So basically, a place where you want to start a business, not a place where you want to get a job.
Yeah.
Exactly.
If you're the owner of a business here, you're probably doing pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
But there's also not a lot of jobs because everything is so automated. There's just robots everywhere doing everything because it's cheaper to build a robot than to hire a person.
And train it. Yeah.
Yep, Phantom will do gross great here. Alright, so so we're basically in the Hotel California. You can check any time you like. You can never leave.
You can stop it with your steely knives. Oman. Okay, let's go to our sentencing or whatnot.
Yeah, whatever.
So you were at the hotel.
Mm-hmm.
How did you find out about the other group being there?
They dragged one of us up to the room and made threats.
They talked with. Didn't they talk with you, Kent?
It was one of us. It might have been me.
I think it was you because Mars.
I can't remember this at all.
That's right.
This sounds like something I planned but didn't actually like
use. Lamont and I stayed at the bar. Kent went up to the room. When we went to the room, he got abducted, and they dragged him up to the...
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That starts to sound more familiar.
Because Kent's got to be different. Because, yeah, I remember us doing that. We were like, oh, gotta go off by yourself and get in trouble.
Yeah. Logan and I saw him come in. We were just sitting there drinking, just whatever happens.
Yep.
And then get a call or something. Yeah, so this is happening.
Okay.
That was the cop.
Yeah, let's back up and do that scene again. you guys are also, like, throughout this entire day that you've been doing things, there's been, like, like hiccups here and there about your itinerary. So when you got to the spaceport, like nobody came out to like greet you. There was just the robot, awesome bot, automated thing. They sent a taxi. The taxi had your itinerary, but then it brought you to the hotel. The hotel didn't expect you for another day because you got there so fast. You had that, like, basically, like, critical jump to the system.
Yep.
Which got you there. Yes. It got you there a day early. So that's something to keep in mind, is you keep expecting, like, I don't know.
Good things,
like, maybe either, like, people to meet you or, like, the police to come, like, talk to you or something like that, because you're on trial, like, you're wanted, and they set all this stuff up, but you haven't talked to any cops yet, and, like, you're getting by because you're expected, but everything's like, oh, you were supposed to be here tomorrow. Well, let's get you set up, you know. So, Kent goes up to the room, the elevator music is playing, and then, you walk down the hallway towards your room. It's this like fancy sort of like dark ceramic material on all the walls and the floors. Like you can hear your like boots like kind of click clack on the floor. It's very bright. There's like neons and stuff on the ceiling, and you can see at the end of the hallway there's like a huge glass window that. It gives you a view of the rest of the city, all the like grav cars flying around, the clouds hanging low in the air, and yeah, you feel a somebody sneaks up behind you, puts a pistol on your back, and then in a modified, it sounds like they're using like a voice modifier, says, "Don't move.
I'm gonna burn your bread."
Just
what?
It's from Super Troopers.
Yeah. Super Troopers. I was trying to think of where that was from.
Yeah. I'm gonna show you where the goose goes. Anyways, right, I'm sorry.
I just I think I have Super Troopers and I can't get it out of my head. So yeah, you feel a gun on your back, and somebody says, "Don't move," like right in your ear.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Not moving. So my name's Kent. This is probably a case of mistaken identity. How about you tell me what you're looking for, and
we know who you are.
Okay.
Like a gloved hand reaches around and grabs the the hotel card, key card out of her hand.
Yeah, sure, take it.
And then kind of steps forward to the door and then unlocks it. And then says, "Go in, slowly."
Yeah, okay. Slowly, okay. I'm checking to see what the heck.
Give me a roll.
All right, D20, 2D6, what am I doing?
What do you want to do, and what skill do you want to use?
I'm trying to see if there's possibly a way I can, like, reach my comm pad and call for help.
Yeah. I'd say that's stealth with agility, or with dex, I mean.
Okay, so I do not have that skill, and my agility sucks. So...
So it's probably going to be obvious.
Sweet.
Just cross your fingers.
Yep.
Can't believe in you.
No, you don't. Don't lie.
Not
in
life boxes.
Lamont and us are raising our glasses saying, believe in Kent.
Kent. And somehow we're just like, Kent. It goes from Kent to Kent.
Oh, you actually did pretty well. Yeah. So, you remember, because you've been in situations like this before, so you remember the, like, facile sequence to reach whoever. Who are you trying to contact?
I'm trying to contact Spike.
Okay. Wow, what a dick move. Right.
Spike, your phone vibrates on the bar counter.
Hello. Oh. Yes. I think we need to go get Kent.
Why, what's going on?
Yeah, you answer the phone and all you hear is like muffled like pocket noises.
Alright, no, this is how I actually do it. So, okay, I answer the phone and I hear that. I roll my eyes and go, Lamont, I think Kent's in trouble. We should probably go check on him.
He's either in trouble or he's butt-dialing you.
He had to go alone. So, let's go see.
Alright, let me get this last drink real quick, and then I raise, like... And then I just down it, and then let's go.
Who's left on the ship, by the way? I know Dave was, I think.
Kyle.
No, everybody... I think everybody got off the ship. Like, we made it a big deal that everybody got off the ship.
Yeah, everybody.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so they're all with you?
Dave is wandering the streets, I think, is what happened last game.
Yeah.
Yeah, then Kyle's going to come with us.
Dave was freaking paranoid about Phantom, so he was off looking for information or signs of impending robot apocalypse.
Oh, okay.
Rose is, I'm assuming, in her room with her face in a book. What'd you get, a new kitten, Logan?
We did.
Aw, it's so cute.
Aww.
His name is Marvin.
Marvin.
They found him in, so her, Jenica's grandmother was at a rehabilitation center after getting surgery, and they found a litter of kittens in the AC unit in Marvin.
Oh, wow.
So, the grandmother was absolutely had to have one of those kittens. So we took it home.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, that's neat.
Yes.
Right.
So yes.
Back to the game.
Yes. Sorry, kittens.
Cuteness does not overpower
being sued.
Exactly.
Nope.
I want to quote some like anime that says like cuteness is eternal, cuteness is never mind. Anyway,
it would be an anime.
Yeah, I was gonna say it would be an anime to do that.
So Kyle, Lamont, Spike, Rose, yes.
Yes.
And is Tomato with us?
Yeah,
Tomato is, we didn't actually say where Tomato was. Like, we know she got off the ship, but we didn't, like, keep track.
Okay.
I'll say she's with, Dave.
Dave?
I need to get a...
I'm just gonna shoot a quick, text to the both of them, just seeing if they're okay while I'm on my way up.
I need to get an icon
text,
for...
Under a tomato thing, you have her name with a tomato emoji.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I don't actually have her net. I just have a tomato.
Because how many tomatoes do you have in?
Yeah, exactly. You gotta use that.
Awesome.
You're like, finally, this is relevant.
I've waited so long.
just need like a generic person.
Should we maybe like when the
I'll make her an alchemist.
Alright.
Should we tell them just to keep their eyes peeled or to head back over here?
No, just that, you know, if they're okay, have they seen anything strange? The usual rundown.
Alright.
We don't want to alert trouble because then they, you know, might freak out and run.
Especially because we don't really know what we're up against.
Yeah.
Oh, man. What is her real name?
I really hope you're recording this, Matt, because that was great.
I am. I'm making a token for her. And I, you know, type in tomato. And then I'm like, fuck. Like, what's your real name?
I know it sounds close to tomato because there's no way.
I know that's why. Yeah.
Tomiko told the now.
Okay. Yeah, she's Japanese. That's why.
Yeah.
Well. Oh, God. What's her real name? That's good shit.
There we
Tell
go.
Tell me now or something like that. Ba-ba-da-ba-da. She's the alchemist.
Alright. Spike, you receive a message on your PDA.
Bring. I'll look at it. Is it empty? I just laugh. When I read this while walking up. That's what I respond with.
What?
Okay.
Oh, okay, man. And I'm just thinking, like, who is shooting at us now?
I look at you, and I'm like, so if this gets hairy, you got protection?
Bring no, with you? Because we gave all of our guns up when we got on this planet, right?
Did we?
No, we did not. I didn't.
I do not remember that.
No? Was that a different planet? Okay. Well, cool.
That was something that was supposed to happen, but no one came to collect your guns.
Yeah, so I was gonna say
because I remember
that's what happened. Okay.
Yeah, we were supposed to I was gonna be like, no, I got you get my room. I got like 3 suitcases worth of an armory.
Yeah.
I remember that Dave and Kent each brought one gun, and Kent's had brought his power armor.
I think with all the like cameras and stuff like that, you guys decided to
not do that.
Be incognito.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mostly. Yeah. Like, if you're gonna bring weapons, small arms, not...
Yeah.
Like, pistols.
Like, let's not bring the rocket launcher.
Pistols, Pistols and grenades is basically what I have. I think I actually have... Let's see, I have it written down, actually, what I had, just in case I forgot. I brought just all my small arms. My sword. My kinetic wraps.
A sword?
Yes, I have a sword. My grenades.
Why wouldn't he have a sword, Ken?
Why wouldn't I have a sword? Come on!
Because
he's a midget assassin, remember?
I have to have a sword. It's taller than I am. No, but yeah, I brought basically everything but my shotguns and my plasma projectors and the rocket launcher, of course. So I'm good.
Yeah, I've just got my pistol on me, and I'll say one flash grenade.
Yeah, on me right
and
now.
Kyle's got her little knife that uses her crazy psychic powers.
I have my on me. I have my little like belt knife because you know, I'm wearing a belt. My
oh yeah,
yeah. My mag pistol, and yeah, I also have a flash with me. Like, that's just on person app right now. I have the rest in the suitcase in my room.
All right. So, was anyone in the room prior to Kent going up? Or are you all coming up?
I believe we were all downstairs.
Okay. Everybody but
Kent. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so you guys are going to be coming from down here. Does that work?
It worked. Okay.
I don't know.
So where's yeah. Kent, I guess, right?
One of those okay. things.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Okay. But you're still a few moments away.
Yeah.
All right, yeah. So the person, yeah, unlocks the door and it motions for you to go in, Kent.
Okay. Wow. This is, so you want to come in?
Can we still hear this over the phone?
Go. Or do
we
hang slowly.
Yeah, I'm putting this on speakerphone.
So you hear like,
so, who are you exactly? Like, tell me about yourself. What do you do for a living? Who do you work for?
In.
Where were you?
And they jab the weapon into your back a little bit harder.
Okay, I'm walking forward, and I am trying to pump for information as I walk forward. So,
so yeah, you go into the hotel room is... it's fairly big. There's like two different bedrooms, like a little kitchen area, and then like a living room with like hollow projectors everywhere. So it's like a pretty decent sized hotel. You go in and the person gestures with the pistol. They show you the pistol now. It's a mag pistol. Mm-hmm. Yep. And gestures towards one of the like couches and says, mm-hmm. "Sit."
Wow, this room number 1321 sure is very nice and luxurious. I am super glad to be in room number 1321 right now with this armed assailant.
Ah, son of a bitch. So they push you down onto the couch. Do you like try to resist or?
I'm like sitting. I'm trying to obey all these commands while I'm doing the stuff.
Okay, so they push you down onto the couch, and then
yep.
With a free hand, you get a look mm-hmm. at this person. They're like covered head to toe in and stuff like. Basically wearing like a small trench coat, they've got a mask on, cowl. You see like on the where the trench coat sort of opens at the like chest area, mm-hmm. it's they've got a bunch of like tech stuff, looks like data pads and maybe like EMP grenades or something, like a lot of just like little things, and pockets in the body armor that have mm-hmm. like little symbols on them that show, or like multicolored tape that tells you like what it might be. And out of a pocket, she pulls a little device and mm-hmm. turns it on, and it starts to make this like really high pitched noise, like, and then it slowly. Like your ears sort of adjust and it stops bothering you after a second. She sets it down on the coffee table in front of you, and then kicks the door closed while keeping the pistol leveled at you. She says, you're a day early.
Well, you know, I'm good at my job. Is that a problem? Why is it a problem?
It complicates things. And then, so she like clicks the mask off and pulls the mask off, and it's Bridie.
Oh,
Oh,
okay.
You remember the Brighty, the sniper
that we saved from that like hunting planet? Yeah. Oh, from your planet.
Hart. Yeah. That's Hart. Brighty was the bounty hunter that tried to shoot us when we stiffed her on a pavement. Remember?
The explosives expert.
Yes, that
the
one.
the sniper partner of the explosives expert. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah, okay.
Right. So, hey, I thought we were square. What's up? And why are you pointing that gun at me in a very non-friendly manner?
It's not a very friendly planet these days. Also, I'm friends with Hart, and she said you needed some help. She's putting together a team.
Okay, I'm hearing a lot of, we're here to help you, and I'm not squaring with the pistol pointed at my chest here.
She looks at it, and then she's like, old time's sake. Well, this will just keep you honest.
I'm hurt. So what's...
And now, if you recall, you have a history of not being so honest with me.
We paid you. Could we get? Can we just let bygones be bygones?
Eventually, you paid me. So she puts away the pistol, and then she sort of leans up against the countertop where it connects to the kitchen,
mm-hmm.
And she says, "Hard to get a team together on short notice, but." Yeah, I have a location and a time.
For
figuring out what the fuck this trial's all about.
I thought we just picked...
It's a little bit unprecedented for a lord of Bunuel to be taking on a... She kind of waves a hand at you. A merchant company. You had to have done something really fucked up to... get their attention.
Maybe just a little bit. Mostly we just got a computer and we gave it to a person.
Do you know what was on the computer?
Well, from the way everybody's talking, some kind of biological or medical data on one of these lords of Unawell.
She kind of like stares off towards the window for a second. She's like, "Oh, you fucking idiots. Do you have a copy of this?"
You know, I don't really know. Do we have a copy of that?
All right. Well, if you have a copy of it, try to find it. Tomorrow night, this is the address.
I could have sworn we made a copy of it.
You made a copy of it, Lamont.
Okay.
I know you have a copy of it, but...
Yeah, go me.
So yeah, she flicks a like a little electronic business card at you, and she says, "Don't worry about the exterior. It's kind of a dive bar.
My favorite kind.
The only kind.
If you go in there and ask for either myself or Hart by name, I'll show you where the meeting's taking place."
Gotcha.
You still have the females on your crew?
Oh, we've got 1, 2, 3 of them, actually.
Tell them.
Well, I wouldn't count Mrs. Johnson.
she's like, I don't know what that means. She's like, "If they're going out on the streets, tell them to cover up." And then she puts the mask back on, and the little like voice modulator turns back online. She says, "People are fucking savages on this planet." And then she starts to walk out. She's like, she pauses at the door and says, "Oh, is there anything else? You wanted a relay before?" for tomorrow night?
Well, say thanks to Hart. Also, you might want to stop that jammer because my crewmates might shoot you as soon as you walk out the door.
She pulls the jammer out and turns it off.
And I send "Don't shoot" to Spike's PDA.
Okay.
She nods. Okay. She nods. She nods at you. She says, "See you tomorrow."
Yeah. Spell that wrong.
And walks out the. Walks out the door. And the rest of the crew, you see her leave the hotel room and start walking towards you down the hallway.
I tell everyone, don't draw your weapons. Throw it. Just see what they have to say. And then we meet in the hallway.
Yeah.
I kind of
She stops and like crosses her arms and says, "Your pilot has the package. Talk to him." And then she starts to like walk forward and try and walk past you.
I stick my head out the door. It's okay.
I should really see him just pop his head out the right time. We're good, and then close the door.
Okay. Bye, strange person. And we go in and go, "Okay, Kent, so why did you say you needed fire support? Doesn't seem like there's anyone else here."
I was locked and loaded.
Well, first of all, can I say I appreciate your prompt response? Because the last time that happened, that didn't happen. And I appreciate that. <here. laughs> Second, that was Bridie, and she had a gun on me, but... it was Bridie, and apparently Hart's on planet, and she's looking to put a crew together to help us out of this spot that we're in.
Ah, cool.
Lamont, you got a copy of that stuff, that data pad, or that got us into this trouble in the first place?
Do I have a copy of
this? No, I do not.
No, I do. Yeah, I do. And I just like, yeah, it's in my room. I gotta go get it.
Okay, yeah, we're gonna need that. I show.
So you have the card. You have the one room. All of your bags ended up here. And it's like two bedrooms with like a little like. Living room, sorry, I can't think. There's a living room area and then like a little kitchen next to it.
Oh, wait, just, we all just
have, you have one hotel room, yeah.
Oh, okay, well then I'm like, oh, it's just in my bag, let me go get it then.
Yeah.
Alright. I didn't know, I thought we all had separate rooms.
Do you want a separate room, Lamont?
No.
I mean, you can pay for one if you want, but...
No, yeah, it's not on my dime.
I'm cool. I honestly just thought that's what it was. But anyway, okay, so I go to the... Shut the fuck up. I go to the suitcase. I open the suitcase, and it's... all you see are, like, weapons and all this. Basically an armory in my suitcase. And I have, like, a little, like, a secret compartment that I just open up that I keep certain things in. Like, I have a couple, like, just file things in there, and then I pick out this data pad, and I hand it to Kent.
Sweet. So we're supposed to take this, and I'm scrolling through the data pad as I'm talking, to this location, and I show everybody the card. Tomorrow night, so apparently it's a dive bar, but we're supposed to just show up, ask for Bride of your heart, and we should be okay. Also, where's Dr. Tomato and...
your brother?
Well, I know where my brother is. Bridie mentioned that I'm supposed to tell the women to cover up.
Okay, I'll send that message on to them.
Okay. I don't know what's up with that, but I figure if she told me with a gun pointed at me, I should probably pay attention.
Probably, you would be correct in that.
She's as crazy as Hart is.
Well, you know, she has once again caught us unawares and didn't shoot us, so I am willing to, you know, accept that she maybe doesn't want us dead.
I would agree with that.
All right. Sounds good to me.
All right. So how was your guys' day? Was the bar any good?
Meh.
They got all our bombers down there?
The liquor was kind of watered down.
They will ask for it.
It's a robotic bartender. You have to be very specific with what drinks you want.
Ah.
That makes sense.
It's good. Makes for good conversation, though.
Did have a pleasant time talking to him.
So I think we cut to Dave and Tomiko. They're out on the streets. And Dave is, like, trying to do something with his data pad, and then, like, all the little messages come up. Like, you know, like, hey, we need help at the hotel. Oh, false alarm. Tell Tomiko to cover up, blah, blah, blah. So, like, all this happens within, like, a minute. And he's looking around these sort of crowded streets. There's, like, grav trains going by, a string of cars up in the air. And he swipes back to this little tracking program that he's tried to put together. Cameron, give me a roll for Dave.
What am I rolling?
Let's do security with intelligence.
Security with intelligence. Okay. Well, he is security focused, but he is not honestly that intelligent.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. But
he pulled through.
So he's built a little like tracker. So he's trying to find out where this where Phantom is kind of going. Basically almost like a virus tracker. Like he's just trying to figure out places that have parts of its code and copies wherever it goes. So he's got the data pad out and like a little like device attached to it that lets him read some of the code that's getting transmitted wirelessly. Mm-hmm. And he they're at a shop that sells like clothing and like shawls and stuff like that, and mm-hmm. he spots an instance where the virus has shown up in one of the advertisements to the shop. And mm-hmm. It switches to an image. Let me see if I can find it. Hopefully this doesn't reveal too much. It looks like that. And there's some text. There's some text overlays that image.
Uh-huh.
And it says, your enemies are my enemies. The trial is not as it seems.
Knew it.
Crud a buck. All right.
Fucking knew it.
So it says that. Okay. Your enemies are my enemies. The trial is not as it seems. The tech priests can guide you.
The tech priests. I like them already. Let's go join them.
I like the name.
Yeah.
What?
Name the...
So, Dave copies this down. He looks at Tomato. You see this?
So as he turns back around, the image is gone.
What?
It's back to like an advertisement.
It's like a glitch in the Matrix.
Basically.
I'm just going to keep that. I'm going to Google search tech priest, see what it comes up.
Search tech priests, because why not?
We are in the future. We have the internet. We're in space. I think
very true.
You want to give me a culture roll? Let's see what you can find.
Sure.
I don't know. What do you want to use? There's a couple different ones.
I don't have any. Go ahead.
Dave's the only one that knows this, right? We don't know this. He didn't like text it to us or anything, right?
Mm-hmm. Not yet.
No. Okay, I just want to make sure.
But Dave doesn't have any culture except for Stasi. So I'm getting the feeling that he's just going to hit a brick wall. He's going to send a message with that kind of in his head. He's going to send a message to the rest of the crew. Hey, has anybody heard of anything called a tech priest?
What would I roll for that if I wanted to? Would that be culture criminal or spacer?
Depends on what you want to know.
I want to know who they are. That's basically it. Well, at first.
Well, roll what you're best at, and then let me know what skill you use to know. Like, if you use criminal, then I'll give you the criminal element of whatever you're trying to figure out. But
yeah, so culture criminal, because that's what I'm better at.
Okay, you're going to be using intelligence for this one.
Oh, well, I'll make sure if I rolled correctly. Yeah, the five stands true. Don't know much.
Okay, now the spike.
That was a spacer roll, but
let's see what Kent can figure out.
Let's see if Kyle
Kent's got
is
a spacer.
Kent's got a spacer roll, but he's you're saying intelligence?
Yep. It's like information
Kent's
gathering.
Kent's got a decent intelligence.
Rose has intelligence and history.
That could be interesting.
Let me try.
That could be interesting.
Ooh,
yeah,
a niner.
Niner.
That's Rose's role.
Okay. Rose has heard of various different factions devoting some sort of like religious significance to technology, but she's never heard of anything specific to Bunuel or what it might what that might imply. Kent has heard of the tech priests in spacer circles as they were sort of the precursor to the perimeter agencies. So there's a couple of like government agencies or private businesses that basically their entire job, their entire purpose is to handle the misuse of technology. Like they are like vehemently against AIs, AI building. They've basically written all the laws on all that. The tech priests were sort of like the Empire's version of that. They would like show up at places and basically like dismantle technology that they found was either too powerful or didn't belong or was going to be mishandled. There was sort of the enforcers. And all of the rumors about Bunuel's tech priests are they're more like that. They're like this ancient, like nobody's really seen one. There's like wild rumors about them being like robots, like sentient AIs themselves, but they just have like one body. You know, all these weird rumors and sort of like images that people have talked about, and like all these different spacer circles. Nobody's really seen one, but the stories about them persist. So they're just, something's happening. They're doing something. Like, they're definitely like a real thing, but they're shrouded in mystery.
Okay, guys, so I don't really know anything, but basically they're robo-druids.
Basically.
Well.
But I know that they're real, and they're probably around. We could, you know, poke around and see what we could find.
I said we do that.
Sounds good.
Because why not? These guys say they want to help us, so...
And we
they got the offer.
And Dave kind of conveys the rest of this information. Oh yeah, the AI is totally here, but it doesn't want to kill us right now. Maybe.
Maybe. Okay. Yeah, there's always a maybe.
So this could possibly be a trap, guys. Just letting you know.
It's a trap. We're used to that.
All right. Break time, then figure out where you want to go.
Sounds good. Works.
All right. BRBs.